Let's talk about backwards compatibility in SwiftUI. And in this video, I'm gonna show you how you can use the latest and greatest fun stuff in iOS 18 while still being backwards compatible and supporting iOS 17, 16, 15, etc. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Here I am in my very basic Xcode project. As you can see, I just have a Z stack with a background color of indigo and then a button with some basic SwiftUI modifiers. And this is just to speed up the video so I'm not typing out all the UI. The only other thing I did, if I go to my project here, I set my minimum deployment to iOS 17. And this is so I have to support iOS 17, right? If my minimum target was iOS 18, I wouldn't have to do any of this stuff. And you can change whatever target you want by hitting this little plus button over here and typing, you know, 17.4, 15.5, you know, whatever the version you need to support is. Okay, back to my content view. Let's say we wanted to replace this color.indigo with the fun new mesh gradients in iOS 18 and SwiftUI. It seems to be all the rage. So I'm gonna go to Safari here. This is just the documentation for mesh gradient, and Apple just gives me a very basic example, right? Copy and paste. We're not trying to win any Apple design awards here. I'm just trying to show you how you can support both. So I'm gonna highlight color.indigo, Command-V to paste in my mesh gradient. Cool, let's see it show up. No. So it says, mesh gradient is only available on iOS 18 or newer. Now, it gives me a fix it, right? You can wrap it in the if hashtag available version check. And this is, well, it's not the only thing you have to do to be fully backwards compatible. There's kind of a lot of permutations you can do with the add available, but this will cover most of the cases. So if hashtag available version check, hit fix. Now let's walk through what we just got. So if hashtag available iOS 18 star. What this star means, or it's also called a wildcard, basically anything above this, iOS 18.1, iOS 19, 20, right? And anything into the future. So if we're on iOS 18, go ahead and use the mesh gradients. Else, fall back to something. Let's just go back to our color.indigo. And while I'm here, you can also do else if hashtag available, and not macOS 11, we'll come back to that in a second. Let's say iOS 16, because let's say on iOS 16.0, we want to do color.indigo.gradient. And for those that have been around a while, this dot gradient was new in iOS 16 and only available above that. Now we can't just do a color here, so I'll do rectangle and then dot fill, and then the fill will be color.indigo.gradient. Now let's see this work here, or actually on the else, we'll just do else color.indigo. So let me walk through what I'm supporting here. If I'm on iOS 18, give me the mesh gradient background. Okay, if I'm on iOS 16, give me, you know, the indigo gradient, which we'll see in a second. All right, if I'm even below iOS 16, let's say I'm working on an app, I gotta support all the way back to iOS 14. Well then, okay, just fall back to a basic solid color. So here you can see we're supporting multiple levels of various iOS versions. So let's see this in action, right? My preview has the iPhone 16 Pro. If I change this to the iPhone SE third generation, which I have on iOS 17.4, I'll show you that in a second once my preview refreshes. Cool, here's that new indigo subtle gradient that we got in iOS 16 here. I actually don't have a simulator previous to iOS 16, so you're just gonna have to believe me that it will show up color.indigo, but it will. But when we talk about simulators, right, you see your simulator list here. I have iOS 17.4 for a few of them. iPhone SE third generation is on 17.4, so that's why we get that, right? I'm gonna go back to the iPhone 16 Pro and we'll get the mesh gradient to show that we're supporting different backgrounds based on what iOS version we're on. Now, you saw it in the autocomplete, but this iOS 18, this is whatever platform you're on, right? So if you're supporting a watchOS app, maybe say watchOS 11 or a macOS, macOS 15.0. And again, the wildcard or the star will be anything above this. Whoops, I misspelled, or lowercase s is not the way to go for watchOS. But anyway, as I was saying, if you're building a multi-platform app and you want to use the latest stuff, you will have to do more than iOS, right? WatchOS, macOS, whatever you're supporting. All right, I'm gonna go back to iOS just because it makes the rest of the video simpler as I add a bunch more stuff. I don't have to always add all those platforms, but that covers the basic example, right? Like it's essentially an if statement, right? If it's available, hey, use this view. If it's not available, use this view. So it works just like a basic if statement, but there are other examples, right? Let's talk about these modifiers. That's why I have this button down here, where sometimes an entire modifier won't be available for a certain iOS, or sometimes the parameters you pass into a modifier will only be available on certain iOS versions. Let me show you. So let's take the symbol effect modifier that was new in iOS 17, effect and a value. So we'll say dot bounce, just because that one is an iOS 17 one. There's new iOS 18 ones we'll talk about in a second. But to finish this out, I need a value that will play the animation every time something changes. So we'll have a at state private var did send equals false. And we'll say did send dot toggle whenever I press the button. just to get the animation going. And then for the value of our simple effect, we'll say did send. So anytime did send changes, we're gonna play the animation. Right now it's gonna be bounce. So look, when I tap the send button, my little airplane, it bounces. Nice little effect. But let's say I like the wiggle effect more, because as you can see here, new in iOS 18, we got wiggle, rotate, breathe. We got some new symbol effects, but again, they only work in iOS 18. So watch, when I get rid of bounce for wiggle, Xcode's gonna yell at me. There it is. Wiggle is only available on iOS 18. Well, I can't do like if hashtag available, like you can't do that in your modifiers. So again, there's two cases. This case is when the parameter we pass in is dependent on iOS 18 or iOS 17. And then another case, which I'll show you after this, is when the entire modifier itself is only available on a certain iOS. Okay, so let's go back to bounce so Xcode stops yelling at us, and then let's fix this. So the way I handle this is with a computed property. So up here, up top, we can say var send symbol effect, or whatever you want to name it, and that is some symbol effect and discrete symbol effect. So now we want to conditionally return either bounce or wiggle based on the iOS version we're on. So as you can imagine, that is the if hashtag available, the platform is iOS 18.0, and then we get the wildcard for everything above it. And if it's on iOS 18, I want to return dot wiggle, else return dot bounce. So let's test this out here. My preview is on iOS 18. So when I tap the send, I get still bounce. Ah, it's because I didn't change symbol effect down here to send symbol effect. Got to use the variable I created. So now when I tap the send button, I get the wiggle. See the plane wiggling there? But let's switch my preview over to the iPhone SE third generation. Now when I hit send, I get the bounce effect. So we're doing a different symbol effect whether we're on iOS 18 or iOS 17. So that's how you handle it when like one of the parameters is iOS dependent. What if the entire modifier was only available on iOS 18? Again, you can't do if hashtag available here. You can't do that. So I'm gonna show you an Apple developer forums post here by Ralph that shows you a good way to do this with a custom view modifier. So if you've written custom view modifiers before, you have the function body or the content, and then in the content, you just attach whatever modifiers you need to make your custom look and feel. How we're doing this for iOS version compatibility is we have this, again, if hashtag available iOS 15, but this is just this example where this .badge.count modifier was brand new in iOS 15. So if you're on iOS 15, go ahead and append that modifier to the content. If you're not on iOS 15, that means the badge is not available, just go ahead and pass through the content. Essentially, we're saying don't apply any modifier to this content. Only apply the modifier if it's available in iOS 15. So what you're seeing here, this if hashtag available, you're seeing it used in multiple different contexts. Like I said, it's not the only thing you have to do to be fully backwards compatible, but it does cover a lot of the bases. It is like the main tool, and you can see it being used in multiple different contexts. You saw it within the view modifier. You saw it just within the body of a SwiftUI view. You saw it in the computation for the computed property. You can also do this stuff just writing Swift code in your functions if something is only available on iOS 18. Maybe you're doing some brand new Swift concurrency stuff. But understanding how this if hashtag available works is a huge part of making your apps backwards compatibility, and I gave you a few examples. And if you're here learning how to make sure your apps are supporting older versions of iOS, I know you're building great apps, and I always recommend having an iOS developer portfolio website to showcase your work. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.